Hey guys, and welcome back to the Finance Now podcast. This podcast is purely for informational and educational purposes, and it's my way of sharing my knowledge, research, and opinions with you. I'm Anurag Birla, and to start today's episode off, I just wanted to highlight, you know, one of the few things that happened this week. Over the course of the week, NVIDIA actually ended up touching the 144 mark, which was hitting its all-time highs, you know, approaching that $3.5 trillion market cap. Now, what does this mean for AI and the outlook in data center building and chip manufacturing, I guess, for companies like TSM? I mean, obviously, I spoke about this last week. It's huge. The market's obviously optimistic that NVIDIA can sustain this level of growth. I'm not sure I am over the course of a medium to long term. I'm not sure this will be sustainable. And I think at some point, the multiples will revert to the mean. But as of now, this is obviously great news for anyone who holds the stock. You know, maybe some people can think about trimming down a bit of their positions, or if they're comfortable with the risk appetite, they can keep it as is. But yeah, aside from that, overall, I guess the week was fine with the markets. You know, the S&P was down about a percentage point at the week's close, and NASDAQ, on the other hand, was slightly up. So I guess tech was carried a bit over the course of this week, and I think, you know, most of us could assume that NASDAQ was carried a bit by companies like Tesla, and then, you know, NVIDIA, Microsoft, and other tech companies. So focusing on, I guess, the companies that I wanted to cover today, one of them was a company called ENPH, and I've never spoken about ENPH before on the podcast, but it's a company that I like. So, you know, when I get to it, I'll just provide a brief summary of what they do, and then following that, I'll move on to arguably the story of the week, which was Tesla earnings. Those were magnificent. Well, at least the market reaction was magnificent, and for those of you that know what happened, great. I'm excited to talk about that and my opinions on the growth of the company as well. So now moving on to ENPH. Just to give you a brief summary of what they do, they essentially develop and manufacture solar microinverters. Additional to that, that's like their main product, but additional to that, they do battery energy storage solutions, they do EV charging stations, and the market that they cater to is primarily the residential markets, but obviously they've started to cater a bit to businesses too. Now, what's special about this company is that they were pioneers in commercializing solar microinverters. And what are solar microinverters? These are inverters that convert the direct currents from solar panels, so DC from solar panels, to grid-compatible AC, which can be used around the house for electricity purposes. Most houses use AC electricity, so I guess the microinverter helps convert that the direct currents that they get from the sun into being compatible and usable around the house. So why are Enphase's microinverters so important? Well, each microinverter that Enphase produces, they work with an individual solar panel, right? So if one solar panel is dirty, it doesn't affect the performance of all others, which is unlike string inverters, which are the more traditional inverters. So these microinverters allow for ENPH to maintain a certain level of power, a certain level of efficiency, with this ability to isolate each solar panel as individual panels. And another benefit with these microinverters are the lower voltages. Right now, with the lower voltages, it reduces the risk of electrical fires. Obviously, these aren't super common, but I mean, that risk is always there with string inverters, and using a microinverter obviously reduces that risk. So Enphase's product offerings can be, you know, as I mentioned, they can be split into a couple different segments. So their microinverters, obviously the big part of their business, these convert electricity to make it compatible with the grid. Then you have the energy storage. These basically serve, Tesla does this too, right? Like these basically serve as battery storage systems that can be then used as a reliable source of backup power. Alongside that, they do EV chargers. So, you know, enabling your electric vehicle to be charged and powered from solar. So really catering to that entire renewable ecosystem. And they also have an app, which is obviously a bit of a trendy thing, but I think their app actually has some utility to it. It's not a gimmick, right? It enables data tracking on your phone. It enables you to monitor how much energy your house is using or saving in real time, which I think is always useful. And it's like a one-stop shop to control kind of every aspect of the ENPH ecosystem. So let me tell you guys a bit about why I like them, right? Like, ENPH have been market leaders in the US for a while, and they are expanding globally, right? I remember reading relatively recently ENPH made the decision to expand into a country like India. And I know that's not the only country they're expanding into, but the reason I get excited about it is purely because of the market size, right? Like the population size, the requirement for renewable sources of energy, and also the growth of the middle class. People are, you know, I guess the GDP forecasted growth for a country like India is fairly high. In the next 10 years, you know, people are going to be upgrading their lifestyles. They are going to be premiumizing their living styles, their living capacity, their living areas. And I feel like with governments, they're going to be a lot more pushy on renewable energy because of global warming and the risk it poses. And I think that will have a trickle-down effect into companies like ENPH and how they're going to end up impacting the lives of many people across the world in both the residential and commercial space, right? Like another reason that I like them is that their entire system is integrated. It makes it so easy for the customer to build an entire renewable ecosystem in their house and keep it under control and monitoring, right? Like they don't have to liaise with three different vendors or contact three different sources in order to get different parts sorted. It's a very simple and integrated system, which makes it easy on the customer, and that's a very important aspect of making your product sticky. I think another reason is just their technological superiority. Like their pioneering of the microinverter is a big edge that they have in terms of, I guess, their R&D capacity and their tech IP, right? So I guess their advanced semiconductor technology allows for better performance than your traditional string inverters, which I sort of touched on before. And I guess the fourth reason is that they're a cash flow positive company, right? They're cheap relative to the S&P in terms of multiples. And that's probably because solar is kind of going out of fashion at the moment. You're seeing the rise of like nuclear and big tech, and solar is not getting that kind of love because it's a high capex business. It's a growth business, and you know, I guess it's not growing at the speed that people want, so it's probably fallen out of fashion at the moment. But I do think ENPH are a strong company in a high growth, or supposed to be high growth, industry. And I think maybe they're just suffering a bit from the cyclical nature of their industry, and I guess the impacts of high interest rates for so long. But moving away from ENPH as a company and why I kind of like them, onto the more relevant topic of their earnings, which was this week. You know, this year in itself has not been a great year for ENPH, especially when it comes to their quarterly earnings, right? Like they've missed analyst consensus estimates for the last four quarters. The stock has been very volatile, and going into the recent Q3 earnings, expectations were already low, but to be honest, not as low as what they ended up reporting, which is why there was such a negative surprise. So they missed estimates for revenue and EPS. Their revenue came in at $380.9 million versus a consensus of $391 million, and their earnings were 65 cents a share versus the consensus estimate of 78 cents a share. The main issue here was not even North America. It was revenue from Europe having decreased about 15%, right? And that was a concern because demand there continues to decline. And, you know, when you think about renewable energy and Europe, you always think they're so forward with this kind of stuff. And if ENPH is not able to retain demand over there, what does that mean for regions that are less ahead in that renewable energy life cycle, right? Like APAC and North America are not as advanced, I would say, as Europe in terms of adopting these sorts of environmentally friendly technologies. So that's obviously a worry for a lot of analysts. And another negative was that guidance was very weak, with the revenue outlook for the company for the coming quarter coming in below consensus, right? They guided between 360 million and 400 million in revenue for the coming quarter. So, I mean, you know, what was the results of all this? The stock was down about 18% in the morning session, right? The day after results came out. So that's a huge drop, even for a volatile stock like ENPH. The stock price, if I'm not wrong, is down to about 80 something now. I think it closed the week at 81 or 82. And that sort of begs a question to me. It hit 52 week lows, if I'm not wrong, or it hit its lowest point this year, that's for sure. And for me, I guess the thought I was having was, is this an overcorrection and a buying opportunity, or is this going to be an attempt to catch a falling knife? And, you know, I came to the conclusion in my head that, in my opinion, it's a big, big correction, right? But I think that correction is, a lot of it, I think, is based on short-term fundamentals, right? It's 43% down from its 52-week high, 40% down year-to-date. It's faced a lot of tough moments this year, right? There's a big drop, but I still think the long-term value proposition of this company is that it has solid technology and innovation behind it, right? It addresses an actual problem that will manifest itself in the future. It's an inevitable problem that is going to show up in some way or the other, and we as humans are going to have to solve and deal with it. So I think the purpose of this company is very strong. And you know, with the way, I guess, with their strategy, I'd like to see ENPH maybe pivot a bit more into more of a commercial or business-oriented strategy, you know, with the rise of infrastructure around big tech and, you know, hyperscalers and data centers powering these sorts of projects, right? Efficient energy use is going to be required, and at the moment, nuclear is winning that battle. But I'd like to see ENPH be able to pivot into something that appeases these types of customers a little more, right? So overall, I guess the requirement for renewables is always there, right? Solar is becoming increasingly cost effective in comparison to other forms of renewable energy, specifically wind and hydro. And that's predominantly due to economies of scale. And I know there's a lot of competition coming into this solar market, especially with the residential market, which is why I see benefits in ENPH trying to pivot into a more commercial strategy. And, you know, I think on a more, I guess, macro level, I think the pivot into electric vehicles by the general public is inevitable as well, right? It's bound to happen, whether it's in 2 years, whether it's in 5 years or 10 years. It's bound to happen once the infrastructure surrounding electric vehicles catches up. And I think when that happens, ENPH will be a great beneficiary, provided they can hold out till then. But I do think they can hold out till then, simply because they're an incredibly cash flow positive and, you know, strong flowing cash flow within their company. And you know, you see that despite the slowdown in demand, which means operations and the running of the company is pretty strong. So overall, I mean, I think Enphase is a great company to have. Sure, it's going through some cyclical struggles and short-term troubles, but to me, this just seems like a buying opportunity and something that maybe 3 years down the line, 4 years down the line, you'd look back and you'd either think, why didn't I buy it? Or you'd either think, I'm so thankful I bought it. Now, moving on to the next story of the week, I guess, a company that more people are familiar with, Tesla. Now, this one's a funny one, right? There was a lot of hype. I don't know if people remember the WeRobot event that happened recently, but there was a lot of hype going into that event, which led to a huge disappointment post, and that reflected in the stock price, right, with a big drop. And then going into this earnings, there was not much optimism going into it, and the reaction, you know, after that was the best single day for Tesla stock since 2013, when it jumped up about 22%. So I guess there is something to be said about the curse of expectations and how higher expectations would lead to disappointment, lower expectations can lead to a positive shock or surprise. So maybe there's a trend there. Maybe there's an academic study done on what the earnings expectations are versus how the stock reacts. That could be something interesting to look at or look through or analyze. But yeah, those are just my two cents on the trends that I noticed. But yeah, like focusing on Tesla, what were the positives exactly, right? The first one was obviously the beats on adjusted EPS and higher margins, right? Margins especially, I mean, came in at 19.8% versus an expected 16.8%. And this is big news, right? Given the price cuts affecting the margins previously, their price war in China specifically, inflationary periods, you know, they cut costs to ensure that people were still buying. And now I don't think they've increased their costs too much, right? I don't quote me on this, I may be wrong, but my understanding is that the prices have not increased drastically, which means a lot of this margin driving is being driven by costs coming down. And that's great news, right? Like, I think another positive that was reported was the optimism on the production of the cheaper vehicle, right? Like, that was a big part of what I guess people were excited about. He mentioned, I think, rolling it out or launching it in 2025, if I'm not wrong. Another positive from the call was the volume growth outlook. So 20 to 30% is what was mentioned on the call in terms of growth rates for volume. And, you know, another exciting part was the energy storage business. And initially, this is one of the core reasons I was interested in this business, right? The energy storage business and energy generation growth outlook for 2024 is huge, according to what was mentioned. Expected to grow over 100% and record gross margins of 30.5% on that side of business, which is the best it's ever been. So I guess with Elon, I mean, the WeRobot event had a lot of negative sentiment afterwards, claiming that Elon didn't really give much about what the timeline and commercial rollout strategy of these, you know, new tech products such as the Cybercab and what he calls the Roboven would be. But he had a more diligent approach to telling shareholders about the production timeline of Cybercabs, but it's not something I'm paying too much attention to. I'm not super excited by that at the moment. I mean, he obviously has a record of over-promising, under-delivering, and I'm not saying to not take him seriously, but I think take these timelines with a pinch of salt. That said, however, the outlook for Tesla is insanely exciting. If you take a step back and think about what they're building, it's incredibly special. I mean, of course you have the electric vehicles. That's just your base product line from Tesla. So you have your electric vehicles, which have already amalgamated so much data into its systems. And alongside that, you have energy storage and generation systems, which is starting to pick up, right? Like that need for renewables. You have Dojo, which is the supercomputer that Elon and Tesla are building. You have autonomous driving, which he is determined to solve, and he's claiming that he's going to solve it very soon. You have robotaxis as an entirely new product line, and you even have humanoid robots and AI, right? Like the Tesla bot, which he demoed at the WeRobot event. So the collection of these products and these product lines at scale, not only do they solve a lot of problems, but they can also prove to be just an incredibly lucrative part for the company's revenue. And it's hard to even model out or project so many special tech IPs that this company has and the future value that these segments would provide. So it's hard to even derive an intrinsic value of Tesla as a company unless you just isolate the EV and energy storage businesses. But if you think about where the company is heading, it's an incredibly exciting time. And, you know, it's a business with short-term volatility. Elon is no stranger to controversy. He's going to make sure he's relevant at all points in time. But irrespective of all that, to me, this seems like a stock to hold for a long, long time. And it's one of the most exciting companies in terms of how they innovate. And I mean, I'm not sure what the monetization strategy for all this is going to be, but that said, I think it's a very exciting time. And you know, Tesla is just a company that anyone would be excited by if they were to look at it and think about everything that it's solving. So with that said, that, you know, that wraps it up for this week's episode. I'd like to remind everyone that please, none of what I'm saying is to be taken as investment advice. I am in no place to give anyone any sort of investment recommendations. This is all purely for informational and educational purposes. And with that, I thank you for listening. I'm Anurag Birla, and this is the Finance Now Podcast.